Plotinus was one of the last great Greek philosophers, and he is generally known as the founder of Neoplatonism. This movement had a great influence on Western culture in various periods. He began to study philosophy at the age of 28, but found genuine interest in it only after he met the philosopher Ammonius Saccas. Influenced by this philosopher who had become his teacher, Plotinus was attracted to the wisdom of places such as Persia. So in the pursuit of his interest, he joined the Roman expedition to Persia. But unfortunately, the expedition failed and Plotinus returned to Rome. There he expounded his doctrine for the rest of his life, and his school attracted many of the city's leading figures. Loyal to the oath sworn by his teacher, Plotinus refrained from writing for a long time. He only started to write during the last 16 years of his life, and the style of his writing was conversational. He makes extensive use of parables and figurative language, and at times also tends towards mystical language. His works were edited by his pupil Porphyry, who arranged them by subject rather than in chronological order. In his writings, we can detect many influences on Plotinus. The main influences were Plato, Aristotle, the Stoics, and the Neopythagoreans. The core of Plotinus's doctrine is his transcendental ontology. In its components and their features, it resembles the Platonic ontology, but it does deviate from the latter. The three key words that you need to know when dealing with Plotinus are the one, intellect, and soul. Beyond the visible world, there is the one, which is the indivisible ultimate reality. Below that is intellect, which is a divisible reality. Intellect is very similar to Plato's realm of ideas. It's where you find the Platonic forms. Between the intellect and the corporeal sensory world, as a link between the two realities, Plotinus interposed the universal soul. Part of it is directed towards the intellect and part to corporeal reality, which it creates and within which it is embedded. The souls of men are part of the cosmic soul. Basically, the one doesn't have a cause. It causes itself. It's its own cause. Everything that we know kind of unfolds from the one. Everything has its origin in the one. The external activities of the one result in intellect. Analogously, the external activities of intellect result in soul. What you have to keep in mind is that this unfolding doesn't happen over time. It's not something temporal. It's atemporal. That's just how things are ontologically. The term philosophers use for this language of unfolding or unpacking is emanation. So the idea is that what is full must overflow, as Plotinus says. Thus, the intellect emanates from the overflow of the one, and similarly, the soul emanates from the overflow of intellect. So, while in Plato the relationship between the transcendental world and the corporeal is that of idea to phenomenon, or to put it in different words, original to copy, for Plotinus, all of being is of one substance. On the basis of his notion of emanation, Plotinus develops an aesthetics by which the beautiful in the things seen or heard in our world can be identified. Every perceptible beautiful thing is a revelation of the transcorporeal within the corporeal, or said differently, an embodiment in matter of the supreme presence. Beauty can thus be known only by intellectual powers. Beauty helps bring the individual soul closer to its supreme source. All this forms a ground for aesthetic conclusions, such as his well-known assertion that symmetry is neither a necessary nor sufficient condition for beauty. This idea alone has implications for music, Because in music, at least until the modern period, phrases were usually, like musical phrases, were usually symmetrical. That's why an even number of bars or measures were used to express a musical phrase. But after music progressed, what we got was asymmetrical phrasing in music. Not only did this asymmetry not diminish the beauty of the compositions, but it also enhanced them in a way that hadn't been possible before. Plotinus further claims that a work of art is not imitation, but beauty aspiring for the perfection of form. The activity of the artist is a kind of emanation suggesting a more sublime reality. The activity of art is too directional. That is to say, by means of the beautiful, it enlists higher levels into its service, while on the other hand, it can, through music for example, lift the soul located here to its supreme source. This two-directional view also informs Plotinus's classification of the arts. On the one hand, he examines their aspirations beyond their own boundaries, and on the other hand, in his classification, which was the broadest, most comprehensive classification of the arts in antiquity, Plotinus places music above all other arts. The reason for doing so is music's ability to effect a change in creation. Under the influence of Shaftesbury, Plotinus's Neoplatonism became an essential component in aesthetical thought of the late 18th and early 19th century. We see this influence in Hegel and Schopenhauer. In a later episode, we will talk about Schopenhauer and you will see how classical he was in his thinking. As I said, thanks to Shaftesbury, people became more aware of Plotinus's Neoplatonism. For instance, in Hegel's famous definition of the beautiful as sinnliches Scheinen der Idee, which means the sensual appearance of the idea, Scheinen should not be understood merely in the sense of Erscheinung, meaning manifestation, but beyond that as radiance or luminosity, that is to say, as emanation. Indeed, the idea of emanation was particularly fundamental for the aesthetics of music because it postulated the concept that music is capable of partaking in truth as the substance of beauty. Platonism in the aesthetics of modern time was to no small extent molded by Plotinus. The philosophy of Plotinus had plenty of room for the glorification of art.